Hello, welcome to Shrink Wrap, a program about all things related to mental health and psychology. And we're very fortunate today to have as our guest Dr. Ken Talan, who's an area psychiatrist. He's both a child and adult psychiatrist. And one of his interests these days has been in his parent resiliency training program. And I thought that would be an interesting thing for us to talk about today, to help parents think about some other tools they might use when dealing with their kids. Hi, Ken, welcome.
Hi, John, thanks.
I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit, just in general, about your parent resiliency training, and then let's get into some of the specifics about what might be behind it and some of the groundings.
Sure, I'll give you a little background.
Great.
I worked for 35 years in a residential program for children and adolescents in Northampton. And I had a private practice for 38 years in Amherst, where I saw children, adults, families, so forth. And about 8 years, and I retired a year and a half ago. And about 8 years before I retired from office practice, I became involved in an approach to working with people that had a lot to do with bringing the body awareness, an awareness of what's going on in the body, not just the mind, into the practice. And it was really transformative for my work and for my own personal life. We all have, as I say, obstacles, distressing events that occur in circumstances and situations. It might be interpersonal, it might be medical, it might be life circumstances, whatever. And our nervous systems can get quite worked up. And I know that experience like anybody does. So it became a very important part of my work with people. And I saw that it was very helpful. And then when I retired, I thought, I can't do nothing, but I had this space. So I decided to take that information that I had learned and the experience I'd had over the years and see if I could make it into a workshop for parents, a course for parents, that might teach them some of the skills that I had learned and that I used with my patients. And that would be the beginning. So since I had this space and time, I was able to work on it. I wouldn't have been able to do it if I had just my practice, because that's busy and life and so forth. So I developed it over the 3-4 months or so, and started to advertise running this workshop. And people came, people whom had worked with me, and they wanted more, their friends, people who knew me. Anyway, I began workshops, and I've run several of them since that time, and they've been well received, and I've tweaked them and modified them a little bit. So that's how it evolved. And I think parenting is certainly the most important job in the world, and one of the most difficult for a variety of reasons that we may get into. So this could have been geared towards anybody. It could have been geared towards, I've worked with Iraqi veterans. I've worked with people who have experienced medical trauma, physical trauma, interpersonal trauma. But I thought parents would be a really worthwhile group to work with. So that's a wordy background.
Let's sort of try to unpack a little bit of some of what was in what you've said. So it sounds like part of what you're helping people focus on is how their nervous system may get activated.
Yes,
and,
exactly.
You know, I guess in today's culture, the solution for that is here's a pill.
Right.
And we're going to knock your nervous system back down.
Right.
Sounds like this is maybe more skill-based, less pill-based.
Exactly. I'm not against pills. I prescribe medication when appropriate. But medication only works in a very crude way. It can be extremely helpful, but a crude way. And our life interactions with others require much more delicate, so to speak, interactions. So, yes, it is very skill-based. I teach skills meaning abilities that people can develop through practice. Playing the piano is a skill. Mm-hmm. You say talent, it's a skill. Mm-hmm. And you have to practice. What I teach are skills and why they're helpful. And in the workshop, we practice. I teach them, we practice them. They go back home for a week. They try to practice it or remember to practice during the week. Mm-hmm. They come back, we review that, and we go on to a new skill. And it's a 6-week course, an hour and a half each meeting. Mm-hmm. And there's information too. It's not just skill based. There's information, and the information is based on the current contemporary understanding of the nervous system, neuroscience in the nervous system, why these skills work. Mm-hmm. And as I said to you when we were chatting before, I don't think I'm teaching anything new per se. This is old wisdom, but with new understanding and a little new perspective.
I guess the thing that strikes me when you talk about it is the whole idea of being mindful that this is even going on.
Yes.
That I think for most people who are rushing around in their lives, right, the idea that, can I stop and take a breath?
Right.
And realize how my nervous system has been activated and I'm operating out of a very activated nervous system,
right,
as opposed to a calmer nervous system, right, is brand new information.
Right, right. Well, that triggers a couple of thoughts that I teach in the very first module. And that is, A, our nervous system, survival is central to our whole organization. If it weren't, none of us would be here.
We wouldn't survive.
Yeah. If our ancestors said, I think there was a tiger over there, but I'm really interested in those berries. I'm going to go for the berries instead of watching out for the tiger because I might get hungry. Mm. And they went for the berries and the tiger got them, we wouldn't be here. Mm-hmm. So our ancestors were acutely attuned, and the nervous system is very sensitive to threat. Mm. The whole nervous system, that's primary. I can't emphasize that enough to people. It's primary. It's a primary organizer. What one interprets as a threat varies. There are basic threats no matter what. A parent working with a child who runs away and runs out into the street, the parent sees that as a life threat. Yeah. The child, who's only 2, may not. If the parent gets furious and rageful with the child because of the threat that they experienced, the nervous system of the child is not going to very well learn, and they might in fact be drawn to that kind of activity when their nervous system is activated. You follow what I'm saying?
Oh, sure.
So the parents, on the other hand, a child may be frightened to go into the dark. Very frightened. They experience the dark. It's actually biologically wired in that the dark is threatening, particularly if they're alone. And the parent may belittle the child. I'm using extreme examples. Belittle the child because the parent, at some level, was frightened of the dark themselves and doesn't want their child to be frightened. So they're trying to shame them out of that. The problem with that is, again, no one learns well when they're shamed, and certainly a small child. So that, in fact, the parent may at that point be perpetuating the fear of the dark and so forth. So threat is really, survival is a central organizer for our nervous system. It's not the whole of our nervous system, fortunately, but the capacity to appreciate beauty, to appreciate relationships, kindness, to have compassion, mm-hmm, all that is, we would say, a part of our nervous system as human beings that differentiates us from the animal in us, which is organized around threat. Because our nervous system was organized originally, our current nervous system was probably established about 100,000 years ago. It certainly began later than that, but or earlier than that, but as it is now. So that's one aspect of it. The other thing I teach that's really very important is awareness, and that's what you made when you said mindfulness, awareness, they're often used, even though there are differences, they're interchangeable mm-hmm. frequently. And awareness, the capacity to pay attention to things, is certainly central to our nervous system in an organization. And I tell people, your awareness, your attention will always go to something. You can develop the capacity to choose where your attention goes. So for instance, a pet peeve of mine is the television attuned to the news in doctors' offices. Why is that a pet peeve? I've been through doctors' offices recently a lot as I get older. And the news is on. Well, the news, again, if threat is an orienting focus, what does the news talk about? Threats, dangers.
And there seem to be more and more every day.
More and more because we're looking at the whole world and not just our city, our street, so forth. So the effect on our nervous system is to make it more active as if there were a threat going on. Mm-hmm. So our attention can be drawn to those things. It's natural, it's self-protective, but it may not be in our best interest. So, and that brings us to the larger issue we talked about in terms of our whole culture has an effect on the arousal. That's the second thing I teach. The third thing I teach. So I teach about threat. I teach about where your attention goes. You have to choose where you're going to put your attention because your attention will go to things. So when I'm sitting in the doctor's office, I'm wandering a little bit here. When I'm sitting in the doctor's office, and I'm already nervous about
exactly.
what's going to happen.
You're already geared up a little bit.
Geared up a little bit sure. about meeting with the doctor or my whatever my condition is. And I'm paying attention, even peripherally, to all kinds of activating events. There, my attention gets pulled away, and it pulls to something that's arousing and not good for my nervous system. So the third thing is arousal in the nervous system and being aware of how activated, aroused, the nervous system may be. And it turns out that there is a zone of balance, a resilience zone, mm-hmm. where the nervous system functions best. And we can easily get bumped out of or at the very high end of that zone where our functioning is not so well, and it can go out of it. And that's where we think of someone as being dysregulated in one way or another. And unfortunately, we've had too many incidents reflecting that in our national psyche right now of dysregulation.
You know, your comments make me think about a couple of things. One is this mismatch between parents and kids.
Yeah.
What is anxiety-provoking for a child may not be for a parent, and
right.
vice versa. The first thing I thought about is the child in school who's not very anxious about how their grades in the sixth grade will or will not get them into Harvard Law School
right.
one of these days. And the parents are very anxious about that and how
right.
that mismatch gets played out.
Right.
Because the parents are thinking about, will this kid ever get a job and support themselves? And the kid is worrying about what you worry about in the eighth grade, which is tends not to have anything to do with that. And I think the other part of this is we live in a culture where there isn't much recovery time. So I think about the person who's driving on the highway, who's activated just because it's the highway and everybody's doing 70 miles an hour and somebody's cutting them off and they're late and they're going to a meeting. That if you keep pushing the nervous system up and up and up and up, you know, you wonder if that's partly, and I don't know enough medicine, is that eventually what leads people to hypertension when you're constantly shooting the cortisol levels through the roof and there's no normal recovery time for it to come down.
Right.
And you now not only create a psychological distress, but you create physical distress as well.
Right. From my perspective, psychological always has a physical side. It's just two sides of the same coin. You have a quarter, you have one side and the other side. Similarly, you have a human being, you have a psychological perspective mm-hmm. side and the physical perspective side. So they're intimately linked.
Mm.
And he was saying push in terms of the society and the stresses and so forth. So one of the things I teach, one of the bits of information, and then I can talk about a skill, a simple skill. I teach about the two parts. So everybody knows we have a brain. Everybody knows we have nerves that go to our muscles and move things. And we have a spinal cord that the nerves come off of. What people are more aware of now, but not everybody by any means, are aware that we have another nervous system called the autonomic nervous system. And autonomic sounds like automatic. And it is, it was thought to be largely automatic, not meaning that we couldn't voluntarily influence it. Excuse me. And that nervous system controls heart rate or influences heart rate, breathing, digestion, the vessels, the blood vessels. And so it's really very central to our functioning, and it's largely automatic, as it should be. If we have to think today, oh my God, my stomach, it has to digest.
Or breathe in. Oh no, breathe out.
Let me breathe out, exactly. Or heartbeat. So it is automatic. And there are two parts to it. There's the sympathetic, which is kind of like the gas pedal, and the parasympathetic, which is like the brake. And just as when you're driving, you have a balance between the gas pedal at times it's appropriate and the brake at times it's appropriate. And they work in a simple model. They work sort of in tandem. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like this, like an up and down, like a wave, a smooth wave. That's when it's working best and normally. However, events happen, circumstances change, it gets cold. We get a cold, we don't sleep well, a whole range of things. Something comes in, there's a noise, we have fear, worry about something. Even we have to get up to move. And so it changes. We got a little more sympathetic, and the parasympathetic has to come in to settle back. And if the parasympathetic doesn't have an opportunity, so to speak, the sympathetic is too driven. This gets to your point about time to settle. Then we're functioning a lot on our sympathetic nervous system with very little parasympathetic to balance it. And it turns out that in the normal animal world, of which we are a part, the sympathetic nervous system is to be on high for only 20 minutes. Because in the animal world, you were either lunch or dinner for an animal within 20 minutes, or you got away.
Right.
And the animal either caught lunch within 20 minutes or they didn't have lunch. So, and what happens is if we are in that frame longer, then all kinds of dysregulation occurs in terms of the chemistry, physiology of, and mental functioning, the corresponding mental functioning of our makeup. And that's where cortisol comes in. Cortisol is part of the initial process, but then the cortisol levels stay high, and they've identified people who have trauma, have significant cortisol dysregulation, people who have chronic depression have cortisol dysregulation. Mm-hmm. So it's we're making connections. Science is making connections in these areas. So what I teach is helping people see and have some understanding of when their nervous system is in that hyper-aroused level. Mm-hmm. And initially, we may not recognize it for a couple of days or a day later and say, wow, I was really wound up at that time. Mm. It is possible to back that up so that one can start to pick it up a few hours after, an hour, a half hour, 15 minutes, and then within a short time, one can identify that one is getting, that part of our nervous system is getting too much sympathetic activation. And then I teach skills that can be used in an acute way if one finds oneself distressed, what one can do. And the distress might be fear, it might be intense anger, it might be tense grief, any of the, as we say, dysphoric or aversive kinds of emotional states that are natural, that are normal, and shouldn't frighten us, but people then get frightened and they get
Well, they're part of being a human being.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So the more one can feel confident that one can deal with these emotional experiences, the more one is willing to engage in life that may provoke them. The uncertain, as we were talking earlier, the uncertainty of life. How will I feel in that situation? I don't know, but I'll be able to deal with it. That's really a hallmark of someone who has not just good regulation, but is centered and solid in their life.
I guess the concept of I can't control what's going to happen, but I do have a choice about how I relate to it.
Exactly.
And sometimes bad things do happen.
Yeah.
Life is like that.
Yeah.
I guess the other part of this is we talk about little kids who then often depend on their parents to help them do this when they're young, or teacher if they're at school,
right,
as they slowly build up the resilience to deal with what we'll call normal disappointments in life when you're a little kid, sometimes occasionally big ones. That requires a parent who has the knowledge that not only do they need to sort of stop and assess where they are, but they may need to do that partly for themselves, but partly so they can then be available to their child,
exactly,
who's going to look to them,
right,
to have some sense of how am I supposed to respond in this situation and will I be okay?
Yeah, that's very well said. That was the whole idea behind this. It's not a parenting teaching course. I don't teach parenting. I teach parents the ability to balance themselves and draw upon their best parenting skills and capacities, which are always developing. I mean, no one's a full-blown parent when the little baby's there. Mm. I saw a couple, I remember many years ago, they were both professionals, and they said, we've never had a 13-year-old before. We don't know how to parent a 13-year-old. I said, don't worry. By the time he's 20, you'll be an expert. It's on-the-job training.
Sure.
It's on-the-job training. But the better, the more balanced the parent, the more they're able to be the kind of parent they want to be. And that was the focus of the workshop in the course, to help that happen. And so some of the skills that I teach are either can be used in short-term as an intervention when the parent's stressed. And you made some reference to breathing. People know about that now. I don't teach that particularly, but that kind of thing. And then what I tell them is, more importantly, or equally important, is to practice the skills, because over time, if you let's say your nervous system's often like this, spends a lot of time up there, when something happens, your nervous system's going to jump even more. If you can do certain practices that help to bring better regulation to it, when something happens, your nervous system isn't going to bounce up. I remember distinctly, there was a woman, she had been in a shelter, she had one child, and she also had some drug problems, and she'd wound up in a drug treatment program. And she sat in on one of the groups that I was running. And she said, oh, I learned those skills. I learned that particular skill. And it was paying attention to her body in a way, just paying attention to her body. Most of the time when we're activated, it's almost as if our body disappears. Mm-hmm. And one can pay attention to one's feet on the floor. Mm-hmm. Like we're sitting here, if you're feeling nervous, you can pay attention to your arms sitting on the table.
Desk.
You can do that. And she said, she was sort of advertising it to the rest of the crew. This was amazing. She said, I practiced this and I did it many, many times a day when I was getting worked up or before I was getting worked up. And the teacher at school said, I don't know what you're doing, but your child is so much calmer in school, more able to interact, be more appropriate, not hitting kids, blah, blah, blah. And she said, well, I'm just not yelling at my child as much. That's one of the big things she knew.
Sure.
That she was more regulated, and it played out. We're individuals within the skin, but we're actually in a field with other people all the time. We don't have to pay attention to that, but it's there.
Mm-hmm.
And particularly between parent and child.
And it also asks parents, like this woman you worked with, to stop and realize and slow down enough in the world of running to work and running home and getting dinner on the table and picking up the kids and people complaining that they literally don't have a moment until it's time to go to bed,
right,
to sort of slow themselves down and take the moments it may take, and maybe just moments, to be aware of that, to bring some mindfulness to it. As you say, there are many pieces of vocabulary to use to talk about that, but that people have a choice about whether that becomes important enough to take care of themselves, but also to take care of their kids.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So let me mention a couple of skills.
Mm-hmm.
So there's something called this orienting means paying attention to what's in one's environment. It would be like, anything. I mean, you're orienting. When we're hungry and we're out walking in the city or something, we're orienting to where we can get some food.
Mm-hmm.
If we're walking in the dark, we're orienting to where's it safe, where's the light, that kind of thing. There are two kinds of orienting. There's what's called defensive orienting. And a perfect example of that is the first time I saw a soldier who had been in Iraq, came into my office, and he was there the first time. I mean, usually when people come the first time, I say, you know, you just got here, how did you get here? Okay, you found it, fine, good. Why don't you take a moment, check out the office. This is a new place, it'll help you feel a little more settled.
Mm-hmm.
And his response to me was, I already did. So he was looking for an IED. That was an automatic kind of thing, because his nervous system was so high all the time on the basis of what had happened to him. He had been diagnosed with PTSD as a consequence of his experiences there. That's not the kind of orienting I'm talking about. And that is an orienting, and it can be towards pleasure. That is, I'm looking for food, or I'm looking for danger, which is unpleasure or threat. I'm talking about exploratory orienting. That's the kind of orienting that classically a baby does after they've been fed, they've had a nap and they're rested, and they're kind of looking around at the environment. They might find their hand and they're playing with their hand. They'll play with the mom's hair. So it's a natural capacity, right, from birth. And people who do creative kinds of things make use of that a lot.
Sounds like it needs to be done from a space of safety.
Safety, exactly, exactly. So an artist who's under pressure is less likely to be creative in that way.
Mm-hmm.
And there are lots of examples in the scientific world also of creativity that happens, like during sleep, which is when we're more in that parasympathetic, relaxed place. And that's the idea. When we're looking with interest and curiosity, with no particular goal in mind, very key, that's when we're going to be in a more parasympathetic place. So one of the things you can do, speak to the audience, one of the things you can do, even at this point, if you're sitting in your room watching this and it's daylight, or you could do it in the room if it's nighttime, just look around the room in a way as if you're looking for the first time, or look out the window at nature, at a tree, at the clouds, at whatever it is outside. And just casually looking around and seeing what catches your eye's interest. So this, it's not your thinking interest, it's your eye's interest. And you're looking at, noticing if you're doing any judgment, like, oh, that sofa, I noticed the sofa, but look at the tear in the sofa. That's defensive orienting. That's not exploratory orienting. Exploratory orienting is looking at the shape, the color, the size, the shadows, and so forth. And it's quite remarkable in doing that. People, you might do it for 30 seconds or a minute, but many people can feel that their nervous system goes just like this. And they might, in fact, take a spontaneous deep breath which often indicates that the nervous system is down-regulating. It's getting more into the parasympathetic mode. So that's one of the very early...
You know, it reminds me a little bit of, as somebody who's done some biofeedback, the idea of having somebody close their eyes and imagine themselves in a setting where they're doing exactly that. You're at the beach, how does the salt water smell? Can they feel the sand underneath them? Noticing.
Right.
And you just watch heart rates go down and respiration rates go down. And it really changes people's sense of activation or dysregulation.
Right. Absolutely.
Oh, that's neat.
Yeah, you know, it makes me think of something. I hadn't made this connection, but I learned from someone, it was a colleague at the residential program, and she said when she was having trouble sleeping at night, she would do this activity. Mm-hmm. And she would be lying in her bed, close her eyes, and she would visualize herself getting up out of bed, walking down the hall, and noticing all the objects that she was passing. Mm-hmm. And if she realized she jumped like 10 feet ahead, she had to go back in her mind and start over again. And that she was pretty well asleep pretty fast for that same reason that you're describing. Mm-hmm. And I've used it myself. And it is helpful. And like many of these skills that I teach, we can easily forget to do them.
Well, I think
that's
they get lost.
Comes in.
I think what, you know, I even notice for myself, it can get lost in the day-to-day press.
Right.
And in some ways, it's sort of a counterculture kind of way of thinking, because we live in a culture that's very fast-paced, and we're getting buzzed and beeped and emails and messages and and even our electronic devices, which are wonderful for many, many reasons, are constantly giving people a jolt. So rather than being able to be in a place where you can be calmed down, I've watched people who are literally, you can, if they were hooked up to a machine, you could see it, but they're constantly jolted and it pops them up just a little bit because they don't know if it's going to be good news. So sometimes it is, but sometimes it's not.
Right.
And we've created a world where it's harder to get away from that for many people. And when you tell people, put it away, they look at you, what do you mean? And I think most people can really get away from it for a while if they want to.
Yeah. What it makes me think of, one of the remarkable things about we human beings, any living creature, actually, human beings I'm particularly interested in, is that we have something called a lot of redundant systems. And what that means, basically, is that you can enter a functioning system, whatever's happening, from any point. Because once you enter at this point, it's going to affect things that would come in from this point. So when people say, well, you know, how come this works and this works? It has to be one or the other. Well, it doesn't. They can both work. They're just entering, they're very different, and they're entering the system in a different way. And how that's related to what you were saying, I think, or I'm relating it, is that just as fear, when we see a threat, we interpret something as a threat, and it's interpretation, we interpret something as a threat, it's going to bump up our nervous system. Well, if we do things that bump up our nervous system, we are more likely to experience something as a threat. So, cold, the cold weather, or having a cold. Most people, if you reflect on your experience, when we have a cold, we're often a little bit cranky, which means that from this perspective, that our sympathetic nervous system a little more on a short fuse, which means it's a little higher already.
Mm-hmm.
And that's natural. That is because our body is communicating to our mind that this body isn't in optimal place and you better be a little more attentive to what's going on. So we are, and it can play out as being cranky, more critical, judgmental, negative, and so forth. So the feedback is when we experience a lot of things that, little things, little T's, you say, that stimulate our sympathetic nervous system, we're more likely to be ready to interpret things as threats.
Already geared up a little bit.
Gear it up. That's, I'm using that term in that way, but more geared up in that way. So it has a quality of feeling of being trapped in a way by our culture.
So I think of the parent who's already had a rough day.
Yep.
And who comes home and, you know, dinner needs to happen and homework and kids are cranky because they're hungry. And that parent isn't starting off from a neutral place and doesn't realize that their little kid isn't going to be very sympathetic or empathic about daddy and mommy having a bad day. They've got their dilemmas, as child-centered as they are.
Yep.
That parent isn't starting out. You know, I can think of somebody I knew who had a very stressful job, and she would say to her husband, "Let me be home a half hour before I talk to you." And she would unwind. She had a job that involved the life and death of others. She would shower and take a deep breath and relax some and calm down. And what basically what she was doing was lowering her arousal level enough so that she could then approach this man she loved without already still carrying all the energy from the day.
He was a very lucky man.
And she was a very smart lady. I think some both of them benefited.
Some people naturally have that. Others of us need to be taught. And I'll give you an example of something from the workshop. Someone that I know brought in this example from their lives. They were halfway or three quarters of the way through the workshop. And they said they were going out to dinner. And the husband was already there with two of the kids. And the wife was just coming from work. And she came in and she sat down and she said, "Give me 2 minutes." Mm-hmm. And she closed her eyes, and I'll describe this skill in a minute. She closed her eyes, felt her feet on the floor, felt her seat on the chair, sat there for about a minute, and then opened her eyes. And the husband said, "What was that?" And she said, "A lot better than having me yell at everybody, isn't it?"
Yeah. I mean, that's a great example.
Yeah, yeah. So here's the skill. So this is called grounding. So what I do, and people in the audience, you can try this out.
Try it at home.
Try it at home. You can try this at home. You can do this at home. So you could either close your eyes or look at a spot 8 feet in front of you on the floor. Basically, the idea is to shut down the stimulation coming from the visual system. 80% of the information coming into our brain comes in through the visual system. And even ordinary things might not seem like they're going to be activating, but they can be, even at a low level. And we want to put that aside. We want to bring the nervous system down into a more parasympathetic place. So close your eyes or look at that spot. And you're sitting in a comfortable chair, hopefully. And as you do that, notice that you're sitting. Feel your seat on the chair or sofa. Feel your back against it. And now bring your attention to your feet on the floor. And see if you can bring your attention to your toes of your feet. And if you can't feel your toes, wiggle them a little bit. And then bring your attention to the sides, outer sides of each foot. And feel that making contact with the floor or the sides of your shoes or sandals or whatever you're wearing. And then the inside over the arches. Now the back of your heels. And now bring your attention to the whole foot as it's making contact with the floor. And then I invite you to bring your attention to your body. Just scanning your body. And see if there's any place in your body that feels a little different. I might feel a little heavier. Just wherever your attention goes, to a place that's more neutral or pleasant. It may go to an unpleasant place, but you have a choice. You can bring your attention, as I said before, you can bring your attention to where it's more comfortable in your body. Resting there a little bit, and since we're on television, we'll only do it for a little bit. And then you can open your eyes and notice.
Mm-hmm.
And it may take some practice, and some people may not find that particularly settling. But many, many, many people do find that settling, and that's called grounding. And you can do this on your own, anytime, any place.
And you can close the door to your office.
Close the door.
You can do it in the bathroom. You could do it. Any little privacy you can grab
when
for 5 minutes.
When you're sitting on the bus.
Yeah.
You can do it. And you can do it with your eyes open if you bring your attention to your feet
mm-hmm.
and your seat and do that for 15, 20, 30 seconds. Because that was sort of spontaneous.
Mm.
And if you might wind up taking one of those breaths. And that's a signal, again, that your nervous system is a little more better regulated. And doing that multiple times during the day, that alone, and if you combined it with a little bit of the exploratory orienting, taking a look, push away from the computer, and look out the window, look around the room with that more non-judgmental, exploratory, mindful is another term,
mm-hmm.
perspective, you'll be doing your nervous system giving your nervous system a great gift.
Oh.
So those are there are a number of other things
mm-hmm,
that I can
mm-hmm.
teach that are part of the
course. And it sounds like the goal of all of that is to empower people so that they can use those skills.
Exactly.
To slow themselves down.
Exactly.
Psychologically, physiologically.
Exactly.
And then, since we're talking about parenting, to be able to both do that for, help their kids do that, but be in a place where they can encounter whatever kid dilemma,
situation
comes up, and there always are new ones when
Absolutely.
You're parenting.
Absolutely. Yeah, you made a reference before, and I just go back to that. another thing that I teach is that time is a wonderful resource. That is, as a resource, something that's very helpful to people. So taking the time to do some grounding, mm-hmm. taking the time mm-hmm. to put oneself in a quiet place. That woman said, give me some time to settle. And a parent can also say that to a child. It's a wonderful lesson. The kid says, can we go da-da-da? I need a little time to think about that. No, I want to know now. I wish I could tell you right now, but I need some time to think about it, to get my thoughts together, to look at the whole picture.
You know, I think in the long list of mistakes I made as a parent, one of the things I got right was our daughter coming in at 4 o'clock in the morning
mm-hmm.
when we had already assumed, dear God, where is she? And she stood in front of the house and I looked at her and I said, you know, we all need to go to sleep. We'll have a conversation about this tomorrow.
Right.
That there would be nothing good that would come out of
exactly.
my activated upsetness,
exactly.
scaredness.
Right.
That would be useful to either one of us.
Right.
Sometimes you need to give yourself permission to do that.
Absolutely. It's a wonderful resource. And I don't think we really give that to ourselves and our children. Take some time. Why don't you think about that a little bit? Decide what you want to do. Take some time. It's an incredible gift.
It really is. Well, Ken, thanks so much for being with us today.
Well,
this
thank
has
you
been
for
great.
Inviting me.
I appreciate learning about your parent resiliency training program and talking in some also broader ways about sort of how people may think about some of this a little differently and learn some very specific skills to actually improve their life and maybe their lives as parents and helping their kids do that as well. A good way for people to get in touch with you is kentalan.com,
T-A-L-A-N. They can just put Ken Talan into Google. There aren't many around.
So you'll pop up.
Ken Talan MD or kentalan.com, I guess.
Great. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
It's been great having you with us today. See you next time.